Everybody, it's Fight Club Hubs here. Welcome to another wonderful edition of GVN Live. I am once again resuming hosting duties, and I just want to give a big shout out and thank you to everybody for taking turns and having fun while doing so for the month of October. So thank you, Mark and Keith, and big thank you to Emily, who is unfortunately unable to join us tonight, and hope to see her again in the future. Probably next show, she'll hopefully return. So thank you, guys.
Well, thank you for giving me the opportunity there, Hubs. I really appreciate it, sir. And I had a lot of fun doing it and interacting with everybody as far as like with Mark as host and Emily as host. It was a lot of fun.
Good. And just want to say hello to all the viewers right away. Nick is right there in the chat room saying what's up. So shout out to you, buddy. How are you guys doing? Let's start with you, Mark.
I feel like life is presently treating me like I slept with its sister. No, I got a lot going on right now. Work, school, getting ready to move. Just so many different things I'm dealing with all at once. It's definitely a big mess. And it doesn't help. It's in the middle of the holidays on top of it all.
No, it does not at all. So,
it's like if life's going to kick you, it's going to kick you while you're down and just right in the balls for that matter.
Mm-hmm. And how are you doing today, Keith?
I'm doing pretty good. I can't complain. A lot of work, a lot of work. So that's really about it. I've still been finding my time to do my stuff or try to, but things are going well. I can't complain because they hit me if I do.
All right. So we are now a couple of weeks. In fact, we're a week away from Thanksgiving. Oddly enough, this month is going by real fast. Can you believe it?
Yeah, like, really.
It was just literally 2 weeks ago. We had our last show on Halloween, and just like immediately, we just went straight into November. November is just like steamrolling by, unbelievably fast. So,
good. Fuck 2016.
Yes, yes. I actually kind of have to agree with you on that one because so
everybody,
much...
everybody wonderful died.
Yes.
Yeah.
Too many amazing people have died this year. It is not funny in any way, shape, or form. So this year is almost coming to a crawl. Let's hope 2017 is a better year. Now to move on, let's just talk about what we've been playing lately. I will start with you, Keith. What have you been up to, buddy? What have you been playing?
So, as of right now, and I actually came to the epiphany today while playing it, I've been playing a lot of Titanfall 2, and I found out that I just suck at friggin' Titanfall 2. And it's all like, I'm thinking like, oh, this should be my new streaming thing. It's like, watch me suck. It's like, it's horrible. I'm like just playing it, and it's a lot of fun. Great game. But I just suck at it so bad. Like, I'm just getting my ass kicked left to right, but still having fun regardless with it. And then I was playing ReCore. That's still a lot of fun. And then I picked up Monster Hunter again, which was a lot of fun. So I've been a little all over the spectrum. But mostly it's going to be with Titanfall. Then you got Pokemon coming out soon. And then the Last Guardian will take up the good majority of my time.
All right. So how about you, Mark? What have you been playing lately?
The only thing I really had time for to any extent is Final Fantasy XIV. Like I've completed the Ashes of Ariandel DLC. And side note, the final boss in that, bullshit. But I completed that, so I've just been working on Final Fantasy XIV, trying to get my way through the first expansion that they released for it, Heavensward, and the associated content with that, which is time-consuming, shall we say.
Needless to say.
I'm hoping to get through all of that before the next expansion comes out, I believe in the beginning of 2017. So I've got, you know, a couple of months left to do that, which, again, between coursework, working, moving, and everything else is challenging. But I feel like I'm making good progress. It's definitely an experience where I feel like it's a much better game this time around from what it was when I played the first time.
I was about to say, did you actually play it the first time? Because I did, and the game was absolute and utter horseshit. Ugh, it was hard.
June, Tahoe says. So I've got about 7 months at this point. Well, I didn't play when they first released it. I played right after A Realm Reborn came out, which was when they said, hey, this game sucks, and everybody says it sucks, so we're going to take 6 months to retool everything. So I jumped into it right after it was finished being retooled, and I enjoyed the game for what it was, but once you hit level 50, everything that was available to do was just terrible. And I was like, yeah, I don't want any part of this. I don't want to spend, 30 hours grinding the same damn fight over and over again just to hope to God that I can, get this one drop that I need to move on. Because it's post-game content rarely interests me unless I have a specific group of people to participate in it with, which I didn't. So this time around, there's been a lot more content just to keep me occupied. There are things to do, even if you don't necessarily want to rush through the story. There's Palace of the Dead, which is kind of an accelerated roguelike sort of mode that you can do within the game that not only gets you experience for your character, but gets you loot that you can put up on the auction house or use in developing your character, depending upon what you need out of it. There's a house, and you can get little apartments in your house that you can decorate how you wish. There's, the gold saucer where you can do chocobo racing and participate in little mini games that they have in there and so on. The game is a lot more robust now than it was when I played it the first time, and there's just a lot more to keep you occupied if you don't necessarily feel like you're going through all of the story missions, or if you've just gotten up to, a group mission that you don't feel like dealing with at that moment.
All right, so pretty much in the end, you're just really enjoying this a hell of a lot more than you originally intended you would, right?
Yeah.
So, my question is now, because Final Fantasy 15 seems like it's more team-based oriented, just like Final Fantasy 11 was. Is it, let's say, kind of like what most of the MMOs are nowadays, where they have a very... Well, is the game easy to play in terms of, if I want a solo? Or does force you at more than just, let's say, event dungeons and stuff like that team up?
No. The game, generally speaking, you can play through some of the missions with a party, but there will be instances where you could really only play by yourself. It's only small sections where you'll have to drop from party temporarily to complete an instance battle that they have set up.
Well, I remember in 11, literally in 11, it was
don't fucking talk to me about 11. We'll be here for an hour. Jesus Christ.
No.
Okay. 11 was built off of the EverQuest model. So in 11, you would play to about level 10 solo because you didn't have much of a choice. And then maybe to 15, I generally found that you had to play to about 15. And then you would put your flag up and you would go to the Volcrum Dunes, because at the time that I played, that was literally the only place you could level. And then you would just have to put your flag up for the whole rest of the fucking game because you could not solo, because anything at your level would kick your ass.
Yep, I remember that. It was oh, I want to go take a shit. Well, you make sure that you have a party with you if you're going to take that shit.
You had to go into parties, and you would get 200 experience points for fighting enemies that were at the highest possible level of challenge you could manage. And you would just have to grind out battle after battle after battle after battle for 200 experience points each time. It was just a chore. It was rough. In this game, the only time where you have to play with people is in specific instanced dungeons, which will either be a full-on dungeon, which will be a four-man affair, usually. Occasionally, there'll be an eight-man dungeon or a raid or something like that. And eight-man trials. And if you don't have friends to do it with, you can just put yourself in a queue, and the game will build a party based on what that queue needs. Because every instanced dungeon, every raid, etc., has a strict composition that it knows that you need. One tank, one healer, two DPS. If you have an eight-man, two tanks, two healers, four DPS. It will build that from anybody who is searching on any of the servers. So you could be playing an 8-man raid and have 8 people from 8 different servers in your group, and the game knows just how to plug that all in and put it together and send you to work.
That actually sounds real good. I like that.
They have also set up roulettes for players who have already completed this sort of thing. Because in theory, if you aren't helping somebody do this dungeon, you're probably not going to go back and do it again. So they've created a roulette. Basically what it does is, if you do the roulette once a day, you get X amount of additional reward for doing it. The caveat being that the game will stick you into a random one of the dungeons or instances or main scenario quests or whatever. So it's you're going into this random thing with random people. You don't even know what dungeon you're picking up. But if you can complete it with this group, you get a bonus. And then if there's a new player in it, you get a bonus for helping them complete it on top of that.
So just pretty much it's encouraging you to just play a dungeon system pretty much it's just rewarding people for just, you know, actually trying to play in a dungeon, in a group dungeon like scenario, even for those who don't even give a shit about it, right?
Yeah, it's this, you get a reward just for jumping in to help other people out.
That's
not only that, they also have a mentor based system where new players are paired up in a chat with mentors who will explain, you know, basic concepts and can answer questions. They have kind of a tutorial for each job. So you can go into that tutorial and it'll say, this is the role that your job fulfills. Here's what you do. And by completing those different missions, you get some really nice armor. And I think it's armor for doing it. And you get a ring that boosts the experience points that you get.
Wow, you're actually selling me on Final Fantasy 14 again.
You're starting to sell it to me as well. The one thing I have when it comes to wanting to play an MMORPG now was that some of the, and this is like for a lot of the early ones, like from mid-2000 till about, let's say, 2010, is they forced people after, like, let's say, like in Final Fantasy 11, like, they force you to solo till, like, let's say, level 10, and then you have to group up no matter what. Games like, I would say one of the first games where I actually enjoyed the game the most was Warhammer Online, because you can actually solo that for a good chunk of the game up until you need to start doing, you know, raids and PvE events and all kinds of other kinds of stuff. Other games like, let's say, Aeon, Terra, and a couple of others like Star Trek Online, like, they are heavily, like, yeah, sure, they're MMORPGs, and you can definitely have a lot of fun, you know, teaming up with people, but it's not exactly essential. You can play by yourself, and that still makes the game incredibly enjoyable. And I think if you can have a good balance in the solo system along with the group system, then I think you have, like, a great game. And you're making it sound like Final Fantasy XIV pretty much has all that going on.
Yeah, it really does. And as Tahu pointed out, there's another system that they've put into place to encourage players who might not be interested in the roulettes, which is a sticker-based system, where essentially you get stickers for doing specific events within the game world. And if you can't place the stickers properly, you can get a shuffle by going in and helping new players who are on their first time. So, for example, in my case, I'm still completing storyline content, so I can go to my free company, the Guild in this case, and I can say, hey, I have Leviathan coming up, or I have, you know, Remu coming up. Who wants to go with me? And anybody who has stickers to shuffle can say, I do, and they can help me go through the game, through that mission. Hmm. Not only that, another thing that's really interesting is, if you get to a dungeon and you just do not want to be bothered with that bullshit, you can ask people who are higher level, hey, can you just blitz me through this dungeon? And they can do what's called unsyncing, where they can turn off the level cap, and they just go in with their top-tier shit and just wreck shop.
Yeah.
So if you just want a dungeon done with, and there are, in any MMORPG, there are just some dungeons you just do not want to deal with. You can just do that. You can just say, all right, I'm going to unsync this. You won't get any experience points for combat, but you still get experience points for completing the damn thing. We're just gonna go shithouse. Just let's go. And you just John Madden the whole thing.
That's good. So, moving on.
John Madden.
John fucking Madden! I didn't even make that up. Like, somebody else came up with that.
Yeah. All right, so moving on. I actually haven't really been playing anything lately, other than again the Game Jam show that I do every Wednesday. I just picked up Just Dance 2017, so I'm gonna probably be playing that real soon. I just installed it and I just haven't had a chance to play it yet.
I want to see you fucking play that on Game Jam.
Say what?
I want to fucking see you play that on Game Jam.
I actually did stream it before. I was thinking about starting a stream and calling it White Dad Can't Dance.
I just want to see your uncoordinated ass trying to pull off Just Dance. Because you know what? I've done, what was it? Just Dance 3, I want to say? Dance Central. Dance Central 3. And, oh, man, that is just an unpleasant experience to see in action.
It's actually, once you get through the dance a couple of times, you start to pick up on the choreography. And there's actually some songs that I really enjoy playing from 2015 and 14 that I really enjoy. Oddly enough, let's say Get Low was a great song. I actually enjoy that. The Lady Gaga songs, oddly enough, are extremely intensive in their choreography, so they're a lot of fun. What up? There's a couple of other songs like, fuck it. I'm not going to go through the list right now because there's like, 90 songs in my head right now that I can try and coordinate through. But anyway, the other thing I'm looking to be playing soon is this little beauty right here. Ooh. I just got that in the mail today. And, what do you say we do a live box opening, guys? What do you think?
I'm down.
All right. So,
I want to see what all this hype is about, all this this luau, whatnot.
The hype of the NES Classic Edition, and I actually have a friend of mine, his name is Rich. He got the Famicom version as well, which comes with a completely different assortment of games. So real quick, so just looking at the back of the box, I actually have to say that I really like the color scheme. On the back of the box, they just show you all kinds of games, like the original bad art, really bad Mega Man 2 artwork. There's actually a few games on here that I actually don't own. Like, I don't own Ghosts and Goblins, Gradius, Galaga, Balloon Fight, or Bubble Bobble.
Well, you don't want to own Ghosts and Goblins because you're just going to hate life while you're playing it, is the whole thing.
All right, so,
I still, to this day, do not understand why they keep including Balloon Fight in every single thing that they release at this point.
Yeah, I have no idea either. I don't know why Balloon Fight is such a big deal.
It's like Sega and Flicky.
Plot twist, there's a switch in the box.
So we got, looks like, a retro-themed NES poster here, which is kind of pretty cool.
You can hang that up inside of your locker at high school.
Yeah! Now you're playing with power. Yeah. All right, so here we go. On the inside contents, there is the system right here. I guess you could say...
Wow. Either you have, like, really big hands, or that thing really is that tiny.
Yeah. Why can't the answer be yes?
So...
The real answer is that's what she said.
Yes. So here we go, right here. That is incredibly small.
I just got that.
So yeah, obviously, yeah, you can't open it. Although that would be kind of cool if for a feature you can just open up the
lid
for absolutely
no
reason.
Put like a SD slot into it. Yeah, that would have been awesome.
Yeah, it has like a really small plug adapter, which I'm afraid like that could snap. I mean, look how small that hole is. That's what she said. You were going to say it. Don't lie.
Yes.
And it's HDMI, so obviously Nintendo on the ball with that, although it would be hilarious if it was if they had composite out. Where's my NES? I want to do a size comparison.
Well, it's like a quarter of the size, if I'm not mistaken.
Oh, it is. It's incredibly small. Here we go. Here is my NES. That is unbelievably small.
Holy crap.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what she... Yep. Oh, we're going to stop saying that now. All right, so we're going to put the system aside and...
One more. I do have one. The Picky Center on OKCupid versus real life.
All right, so obviously here's the... the plug is actually USB. So it makes me wonder if I can just, instead of just forgo this... And I have a TV with a USB outlet, and I can just plug it straight into the TV and see if that'll power it.
It depends on if the TV's USB outlet is actually powered or not. Because I don't. Generally speaking, your television does not have a powered USB output. Mm-hmm. Your computer probably will. Your TV, you would have to see what the manufacturer has set up.
I think my TV is because I used my Roku and I plugged it into the USB and it powered on.
If that has a separate AC out, then yeah, then that's a powered outlet, a powered USB.
Yep. All right.
If anything, I just discovered my Roku, and it's so awesome. I love it so much.
Yep. Now, the controller is amazing, actually, because I had to wait on Amazon to buy an extra controller because I was dumb enough not to pre-order the controller on Toys R Us back in July, which, by the way, that sold out in freaking 1 hour, on the Toys R Us online pre-order. And right now, I'm telling you, this controller is freaking spot on. It feels just like the original. Like, it's the exact same material. It just looks clean. It is super clean.
Shiny. Pretty.
Now, the only problem I have, and I read about this, and I'm sure everybody has, is the fact that the cable is only 3 feet in length. So, if anything, you're going to have to end up buying the Nikon cable extension, which is like $10, but those are sold out as well, so it's kind of crazy.
Or until they make the satellite for that.
Yeah. I made the joke thinking that Nintendo did this. Wow, you bought 4 Monster Mutants. That is awesome. You are the greatest wife ever. Anyway, so the thing about the 3-foot cable, I was making the joke saying that Nintendo is forcing us to relive our childhood by making us play on the floor. Like, sit in Indian style on the floor. That's what I thought it was. But, you know, I just think it's just bad design. So, whatever. But I am really looking forward to this. I would have to say, yeah, the one major complaint I do have is the fact that there is no way to get more titles on the system, because 30 games for $60, that is not a bad deal. Especially when I just saw an article. I forget who wrote the article, but they tried to compare how much it would cost for you to actually buy the system and cartridge. And all 30 games plus the system itself would run you about $200. The most expensive, of course, being which is the system, which you can get for about $30 if you get one that's refurbished. And Final Fantasy, which is about $21 to $25, cartridge by itself. So, there you go. I mean, I honestly think that for people, I think there's another good benefit to this, and that's like next year I'm planning a trip with the family to Connecticut to take my kids to Eddyville Family Amusement Center, where there's Thomas Land. You know, my kids are wanting to go there. And I was thinking, like, you know, if we're staying at a hotel or a Motel 6 or whatever, take this along on at the end of the day and just whip it out and start playing. Connected to the little TV in there. I think it looks almost travel size, doesn't it?
Pretty. I think that was kind of also a little bit of the point with also, like, with the Switch being on the go and everything along those lines. You never know.
Yeah. But there's no way in hell I'm going to take a Switch across, like, multiple state borders just for me to accidentally lose it or something like that. That's...
Nah.
No. But, so, there we go. That is the Nintendo Classic. And, of course, just for reference as well, here's the little extra controller I bought right there. So that the packaging is really small. So moving on, we're going to jump to our first major. Well, actually, you know what? Let's talk about the bullshit that's going on around with the NES Classic, and that is the insane amount of price gouging that is going on. Let's get your thoughts and takes on it, Mark. We'll start with you.
It's basically not a surprise or anything. I mean,
yeah.
If you haven't been dealing with Nintendo at any point prior to this, God bless you, but Nintendo is notoriously bad at producing the amount of units that demand would require, whether it be amiibos or their handheld consoles at various points, or this NES Classic, or the little wrist device that works with Pokemon Go.
Mm-hmm.
Nintendo is notoriously bad at making sure they have enough product to meet the demand available. And it's, to a certain extent, that makes sense. You really have no idea how much hype is going to translate to actual devices sold. And for a lot of companies, it's worse to produce 5 million of a unit and then end up with a whole bunch of them sitting on the shelves, making it look like you failed. But by the same token, it's something like this, you really should have anticipated that it was going to be something people would want. And this isn't, you know, something like, again, a Wii U or a Nintendo Switch or whatever, where there's proprietary technology involved and you have to spend a great deal of time manufacturing it. For all logistical intents and purposes, this is probably like a flash drive and an emulator
in like a box, Raspberry,
like an NES. Yeah, it's you could probably build something like that if you had tiny enough PC components to make it work. It's not anything particularly involved comparatively. Like you could probably reproduce something like this relatively easily. So I don't really understand why Nintendo would produce something that has this high level of desirability and then just shove it out there with no scalability, no ability to add additional games to it, and in such limited quantities that it's going to make it very difficult for people to get. And I mean, I'm hoping that they'll probably produce more of them before the end of the holiday season, just to make sure that it's easier for people to get it than having to pay an ungodly amount of money on eBay or whatever. But it's kind of just what Nintendo does. It's for a company that got into the business producing card games, toys, and things like that before they got into video games, you would think that they would have a better idea of how to deal with this shit. But the Amiibo problems and everything associated with it kind of just taught them that people will keep buying your shit so long as you have likable enough characters associated with it. So there's no real incentive for them to learn a lesson on it.
Yeah. Now, what I'm thinking in regards to this is that, granted, yeah, Nintendo, the scalpers and price gougers are going a little overboard, in my opinion. My one thought here is that I think it's going to eventually bite them in the ass, because unlike, let's say, the Amiibo craze, which I think people went really ham on, and at the same time, I mean, it was taking Nintendo way too long to replenish supplies of, like, let's say, first and second run Amiibos. Right away, Nintendo's already in the motion to resupply Nintendo NES Classics, so this is gonna hurt these guys a whole lot. So, like, I saw a guy on Instagram posting a photo where he has 7 of these NES Classics, and he says, "Okay, I'll sell each of them to you, sell you one for $200 a pop." This is a $60 console. You're asking for literally
$140 more.
$140 more, and you damn well know that Nintendo is going to resupply, and it might take at least a week or two. But, and granted, I guess because this is coming out during the holiday season, he's probably going to get a couple people who are desperate enough to buy one. But this is going to be one of those things where, like, the businessman is going to lose out because they are just getting a little too greedy and they're just getting way too ahead of the a game when there really wasn't one to begin with. So, what are your thoughts, Keith?
Well, I mean, this is really just any standard operating procedure, especially during the holiday season. If anything, like Mark was really saying, is that they could have foreseen this. If they think they were playing on a lot of people's childhoods, and they knew that people would go out in massive drones and buy it. So that was the first shame on them, because they're really appealing to collectively all three of us, and probably everybody that's actually watching this show, is that everybody grew up with a Nintendo, not everybody still has their Nintendo. So they were really playing on those heartstrings, and they put a lot of good games onto it. Granted, I think that they could have put a different selection, but still it had the core games that everybody wants to play onto it. So shame on them. As far as the price gouging is concerned, that's no different than anything else. This is pretty much the same song and dance. Like, you could find this with an iPhone 7 Plus. You could find this with any sort of, like, cell phone at this moment, or not every cell phone, but any of, like, the hotter cell phones. It's just that, unfortunately, people buy them and they're like, I can make a quick buck off of this. And then they raise the money for it so ridiculously high. And you were saying that somebody was trying to sell it for $1,000. Now, I don't know who the hell in the right mind would buy it for $1,000. If they did, you know what? Tell me what your name is, because clearly you have too much money and I can take that off your hands very, very simply. So I think it's kind of the same song and dance. I really hope that Nintendo does create some more, but they did this on purpose, I think, honestly. Like, they knew that they were going to sell out and they were going to have to replenish this, and they knew people were going to do this. It's, again, it's the same shit, different toilet, so to say.
All right, so pretty much in a nutshell, this is probably just because of the timing of this whole thing, of when it's being released, and just a lot of factors, and Nintendo just being stupid on purpose, or they know and they just don't give a crap because they, like Mark said, it's because likable characters and whatnot, people are gonna buy it regardless. So we're gonna end on this note, on that note right there. So moving on, we're gonna talk about something rather interesting, and it took me a couple of tries to try and explain it because I just suck with words. This topic is about why do some monster-based games work better than others. So, like, for example, why do, let's say, monster games that are based on, let's say, parodies or mythologies tend to be more well-received and or sell better than games that are based on, let's say, a licensed character or creature, let's say, Universal Monsters, Godzilla, King Kong, whatnot. So, did I phrase that okay? I think I sucked at that.
From what I was... Everybody can hear me, right? Okay, I'm sorry.
Yeah,
I thought it went out.
Fine.
Okay, I thought it went out for a second. Anyway, I think that kind of what we're getting at, it kind of boils down to that also, that age-old conversation of why do licensed games suck, but...
like that, but then again, there are some licensed games in the monster genre. In fact, monster...
That are fantastic.
Yeah, in fact, majority of monster games are actually good, but just some of them either don't sell well, or they're based on a movie license, like, let's say, the Peter Jackson King Kong games. If you know what I mean. So, like, why do some do good, some don't? And yes, the age-old tale of licensed gaming tend to not work out in favor, but then again, you got, like, all kinds of other licensed games. Like we had the GameCube and PS2 versions of Godzilla that were actually pretty awesome. We had, you know, some other based, like, let's see, like, anything involving zombies for the most part. We can consider that a monster. Like, horror monsters are included, not just kaiju or universal monsters, atomic monsters, stuff like that. Other games, let's say, like, It Came from the Desert, which is a parody game. In fact, if you notice, parody games based on monsters are pretty good. Like, you got to remember the Rampage series, both in the 80s and the 90s, were pretty good. I mean, they imitated, like, you know, the Godzilla feel of monsters going around destroying buildings and whatnot. It Came from the Desert was making fun of, like, you know, classic 1950s, 1940s, Atomic Age, you know, giant insect movies and stuff like that. And those were pretty good.
Earth Defense Force, which was another fun game that I really enjoyed for that. And also, would you say Grab by Ghoulies? Grab by Ghoulies was something along those borderlines as well.
Yeah, I don't know. Can we consider all forms of undead to be monster-based? Mark, what would you say would be the ruling on that?
Well, I mean, you can't really license zombies, you know?
No. Yeah.
Because zombies have been around long before we started putting them into fiction. I mean, and don't forget, voodoo practitioners were technically creating zombies, though not in the sense as we understand them from fiction, decades, maybe even centuries ago. So it's I would say that it more comes down to the franchise that's using them rather than zombies being a particular, you know, thing that can be
licensed.
Yeah, it's zombies can be basically anywhere. Like, nobody owns that.
Okay. Now so let's start with you, Mark. What is it about, with, say, certain franchises or games and game developers that seem to make these franchises work better than, let's say, other companies who try and take the same idea and just don't do well with it?
It's a matter of understanding your source material. I mean, there are going to be good and bad ways to put a product into action, put a name brand into action. And to be fair, it's not like we've really been in a position where we could do a lot with these sort of games until more recently. I want to say at least like the fifth console generation. Because if you're looking like the third or the fourth console generation, what do we have in terms of horror games that are memorable for the right reasons? You know, the Friday the 13th game on the NES was dog shit. The
Nightmare on Elm Street.
Nightmare on Elm Street on the NES was even worse.
Jaws. I was going to say the Dracula.
Jaws, Bram Stoker.
Yep, Bram Stoker's Dracula. That game was interesting, to say the least.
Mary Shelley's Frankenstein.
Frankenstein I didn't hate. I feel like adventure games were a good medium for those sorts of things. I didn't necessarily like Phantasmagoria as an example, but I feel like it did what it needed to do, effectively, mm-hmm. as far as horror games went. Mm-hmm. Adventure games that took the ideas of, you know, monsters generally tended to do reasonably well, but you were only going to do so much with horror icons during third and fourth generation outside of adventure games. Mm-hmm. And platformers based on monster characters were really only going to work if they were subversive. Monster in My Pocket being a prime example there. Mm-hmm. Outside of that, you weren't really going to get a lot out of the Dracula experience by playing as a platformer starring Keanu Reeves. It wasn't going to do anything to capture the essence of that franchise effectively. Very few companies tried to do horror as horror was intended during that generation. Like, I think Clock Tower is one of the very few games that made that active effort to try and be a horror game in the strictest sense. So it wasn't until you got to, like, the PlayStation 1 era of gaming, the fifth console generation, where you started seeing games that could more readily try and capture that. So you're talking from the fourth console generation back, fuck it. Just fuck
they it. They were all dog shit. Yeah.
So once you get into the ability to deal with three-dimensional images and use a lot more storage space through CDs, DVDs, Blu-rays, things like that, you start seeing developers try to experiment a bit with the idea of one or many monsters against a protagonist or even playing as the monster. And at that point, it's just a matter of what kind of a game are you trying to make. And I feel like developers who understand the subject matter, developers who understand the material, and developers who are themselves good at making games are going to produce a game that's good in that capacity. And it's not really that difficult, so long as the people developing the game are talented at what they're doing. I mean, take the Alien franchise as a prime example. The most recent game that was released was Alien Isolation. I don't remember the name of the development house, but the developers associated with that game,
they made a really good horror game
in the first shot. Like, it's not necessarily the game for me, but it's great. It's a fantastic experience. Mm-hmm. Take the game before that, Aliens Colonial Marines.
The game that everyone was looking forward to.
Yeah, I don't think it's any kind of a secret at this point that outside of the first two games in the Borderlands series, at this point, I consider Gearbox as a development studio to be deeply, deeply untalented at making anything that is beyond mediocre as an experience. And Aliens Colonial Marines was literally just them taking an ailing franchise off of another developer, pretending that they were working on it, and siphoning that money into Borderlands 2. So that game was never going to be a success. That game was never going to be good. And I don't care how much Randy Pitchford says that there are people in the world who like it. There are people in the world who enjoy having women in high-heeled shoes step on their testicles.
Yeah, that sounds about right.
Somebody likes the thing that you've made does not mean that it is good, mm-hmm. demonstrable.
Well, also, wasn't there all that controversy with Colonial Marines just on the simple fact of that if they were like, oh, here's what this game is going to be, and then all of a sudden they delivered this absolute pile of horse crap.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. But it's even beyond that. It's I don't think they were ever in a position where they were going to...
They weren't going to make the game that we really wanted to begin with because, I mean, like you said, Gearbox is just, they just cycle crap out. For example, Duke Nukem Forever. Like, I think I like that game more as just the myth and the legend than the actual finished product.
Well, then that dude that's been holding on to his Duke Nukem Forever pre-order receipt would never have been able to live the dream.
Yeah, but it's outside of Gearbox. It's even so, there are a lot of developers where you can see that they just don't get it. And this doesn't even necessarily extend to licensed properties. You know, you look at Silent Hill. Team Silent got Silent Hill in a way that no other developer has since that point. It's some developers just do not get horror in the strictest sense, whether it be comedy horror or legitimate horror or whatever. And you can just see from the things that they produce that they don't have that understanding of what makes these monsters interesting, what makes these monsters compelling, what gives these monsters the heart and soul.
They have nothing for the mythos, is what it really boils down to.
Sure, and you can take a game. It's not even about necessarily mechanics, because I love the Earth Defense Force franchise, but those games are terrible.
Yes, they are, but so much fun.
Broken as shit, but they're fun. They're fun, they're well-composed, they're well-structured, they're well-put together. And again, I mean, you know, not everybody likes them. Jim Sterling has gone on record as saying that he's tried many a time to enjoy that franchise and has just never made it work, which to each their own. But for the most part, I love that franchise, and I'm not ashamed to say that I love that franchise, even though it's broken as shit, because it gets, on a fundamental level, the idea of stupid B-movie horror in a way that few games do.
Now, yep. Stepping away from, like, the horror aspect, what about, let's say, more of a... I mean, most monsters, in general, are based on a horror-type setting. I mean, hell, you could technically say the first Godzilla movie was kind of a horror film, talking about the theme of the Holocaust... Or not the Holocaust, the first nuclear bomb that went off on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. But what about, let's say... some of the more platform-oriented and adventure-based. Like, you were talking about adventure-based.
Did you just suggest making a fucking video game based on bombing the Japanese?
No, I did not. I was talking about how... That'll make
good reviews.
Oh, jeez. How did you misinterpret what I just said there? Anyway, moving on. No. What about in regards to, like, let's say... I mean... most of this conversation has been focused on horror monsters, but what about games based on, let's say that, like, dragons and whatnot, like, you know, fantasy based monsters that, like, some of those games don't seem to do well. Hell, you could even say, like Dino Wars. We could even, I guess, include dinosaurs to a point where they can be considered monsters, because there's a whole bunch of those out there, I guess, as well. Right? No? Yes? Maybe?
I think with this particular conversation that we were going with, we were talking more of, like, the actual like the kaiju monsters, like Godzilla and King Kong and
Atomic Age monsters and stuff like that. So yeah, well, you know what, then I guess in the broad sense of things, because in terms of like fantasy,
the closest that you're going to get with that sort of stuff is, like, from a fantasy perspective, dinosaurs are a real thing. The closest you're going to get is, like, Turok and Dino Crisis. So I don't really know if it qualifies.
Yeah, and then again, you got Dino Crisis, of which was more of a horror-based game as well. So I guess, you know, the best way for monsters to be incorporated, would you say, is through horror games, or fighting games, for that matter? Like, let's say, like, the Godzilla games on the GameCube, PS2, to bring that up again, was just a rock'em sock'em melee type of game. Or you can have something like, let's say, the new Friday the 13th movie, where you actually get to wear the shoes of Jason Voorhees and go around slashing, you know, would-be campers.
Well, I think that there's two different perspectives on that, because let's be honest here, that you can't do a Godzilla game as, like, an action platformer, because it would get really, really... like, what can Godzilla has no motivation to actually, like, do a story. He's not like, oh,
save the Earth from Planet X. Did you not play the NES game?
Well, I did, but the point being is that nobody's going to pick up on the story on that. Mostly Godzilla is going around destroying shit, and that's how I grew up. I mean, I know that Godzilla has a much extremely deeper story, especially with all the different monsters.
I'm sorry, what? Godzilla has a deep story? Did you really say that?
Wow.
Godzilla is meant to be a representation of
I know. That's what the first
Japanese,
movie was,
like,
mostly
the Japanese concerns over, you know, the atomic bomb in World War II.
Well,
the character himself, like, you know, is an interesting character. even in the most recent reinterpretation. Sure, it's a dude in a rubber suit kicking the crap out of a dude in another rubber suit, but like the actual concept is interesting enough.
Well, yeah,
I feel like it also depends. It depends on the monster. Like Godzilla would not work as a horror property, even with the most recent remake. It's, you know, there's only so much you're gonna do unless you are playing like, you know, like a disaster report style, ground level. I'm running away from the carnage associated, because one
like
person.
Cloverfield.
Right, like one person is going to have a lot more to deal with than just Godzilla. Godzilla is not interested in a person. It's carnage on a mass scale.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to be about the things that Godzilla does. Trying to translate Godzilla to the video game format, it's inevitably going to be you have to play as Godzilla, and then at that point, it's just you're playing a game where you're romper stomping the city, trying to just beat the shit out of every building, every plane, every tank, every other monster that comes your way.
Oh, yeah.
Whereas with, like, a Michael Myers or a Jason Voorhees, it's... We haven't really seen too many games that try to take on the idea of serial killing, murderer, whatever, trying to hunt down victims to kill outside of... I don't remember the name of the game they just released on PC that's like a multiplayer experience where four people play as victims and one person plays as the killer.
Yeah,
in the
I actually had a friend that was trying to get me to play that. I think it was called Damnation or something like that.
No, that's not it.
No,
that's
it's not. I can look it up real quick, probably.
Yeah, that's fine. But it's like that kind of model could work, but otherwise it's you're going to have to play a horror game.
It's called
gonna
Damned.
Have to be. Okay.
Yeah, the game is called Damned, so I was half right.
But it's going to have to be a case where, you know, like, you are hiding from the monster. To be clear, you can put these characters into a fighting game, which we've seen with, you know, the Mortal Kombat franchise as of recent, and the full-on fighting game that they released, public domain game, made as freeware, where you can play as horror icons against one another. But like you couldn't put Jason into a platformer and have that make sense necessarily.
Yeah.
Or even with like in a first person, even though it would sound kind of intriguing, but I don't know how like it would work out as far as like a mission base. But then again, I guess you could have like your mother talking to you and be like, Jason, they did this, and then go kill them.
I mean, if in any aspect in regards to the serial killer games, I mean, all we really have were ones where you actually had to try and avoid the serial killer or try and save people from the serial killer, i.e. the Halloween game on the, I believe, the Atari 2600, Friday the 13th, and Nightmare on Elm Street on the NES. And I believe there was another game, I think, that was on the Super Nintendo, but I can't remember what franchise it was on. I think they tried to make a Hellraiser game, but I don't remember if that actually came out.
I have no idea.
Okay.
Not as such.
I can't remember because I think I saw it in Nintendo Power, but I could be totally mistaken on that because that was like 20 years ago.
They were going to release one, but it never actually came out as such. It was also going to be an NES game. I think it was going to be a platformer of some type or another, but like I don't think they've even like I don't even think that they have like any indication of what the game was supposed to be. Necessarily.
Mm-hmm.
Like I don't know if anybody has played the game to any capacity or if it was ever released as like, you know, a ROM that people could test out or whatever.
Okay. So I guess we can wrap up this conversation real quick with I got a couple more questions I want to ask both you guys. So we'll start with you, Keith. First question will be we'll go from Keith to Mark right here with the first question. In regards to monster-based games, what kind of genre do you think works best for monsters in general, or which ones do you prefer?
Well, the monster games that I prefer to play are definitely the classic, like, King of the Monsters type games, or even, like, the GameCube versions of Godzilla, Destroy All Monsters? Yeah, Destroy All Monsters, and whatnot. I like those particular ones because that's what I remember those particular monster games as that you just go in, you beat up that monster, you destroy the city, end of discussion. And that was a lot of fun. As far as what I would like to see them be or what they could be, I can't really think of too much as far as that's concerned, because again, that you could do it as like maybe a first person, like kind of do like that Alien versus Predator sort of thing where you could see be in the perspective of the alien. So it's like, okay, we got to hop into this body here. I got to lay the egg and then I pop out of the chest and then I go kill things. That could be an interesting concept for certain ones, but I can't really see them working as far as that's concerned. So I would say that the classic stuff, the older classic styles are my favorites, to be honest with you.
All right. How about you, Mark?
I feel like the games that have predominantly been the most successful overall have primarily been the first-person shooter type games. So, you know, the Alien versus Predator, as you mentioned, definitely has, like, a big success checkmark next to it. I want to say Alien Isolation was also pretty successful to a certain extent.
Waiting for Alien Isolation VR.
That would be that would be pretty awesome, I'm not going to lie. But also, that those have a little bit more of that horror aspect, and again, with the Alien especially, since it has that story behind it of that, oh, you're hiding from the Xenomorph, oh, you're hiding from the Alien. The Alien gives you that kind of that rush, so to say, for it. So you can take it on different perspectives, either as running away from the alien or actually hunting as said alien.
All right. So now, did you have any more to say, Mark?
I feel like horror games would be like horror style games, survival horror in particular, is always going to be my personal go-to, my personal favorite. Though adventure games definitely have a place in my heart as far as that sort of thing goes. I would say if you can do either one of those style of games and you can do it well, you've definitely got a sale for me. But it's not necessarily going to be the most financially viable option if, you know, first-person shooters are available. I still think that's going to be your best bet. That's going to be your best option.
All right. And the last question is, okay, favorite monster game and why? We'll start with Mark.
Oh, hell. I don't really have, like, anyone in particular that's coming to mind off the top of my head. It's not Alien Isolation, because I like the idea of that game, but it just, for whatever reason, it just didn't particularly speak to me. I don't have anyone in particular that, like, strikes me. I like horror games, sure, but not ones that, like, focus on any one particular monster over any other, pound for pound. Mm-hmm. Probably, like, if we're not talking about, like, specific monsters, I would probably go with Clock Tower 2, I want to say, which was the one where the main character had a split personality disorder and was being chased down predominantly by Scissorman, but also by other enemies that were trying to see her dead.
All right, and how about you, Keith?
My favorite one was going to probably be the GameCube version of Godzilla, if we're going to stick within the monster category, and that was Destroy All Monsters Melee. I really, really liked that game.
It was a lot.
I didn't play the Save the Earth, so.
Well, it didn't release on the GameCube, I know that much.
But that was one of my more favorites. As far as the horror genre would go, though, if we were going to that particular aspect, I guess, then I would say Alien Isolation, because that game did scare the crap out of me. Funny story with that is that I was actually playing it on Halloween, nonetheless, with the lights out, my door closed, and I have, like, my headset on, and I'm playing in the dark with my controller right next to me, and then all of a sudden I'm in a basement, so I hear something drop on top, and I'm like, what the shit? And then the alien comes right out, kills me. It was funny, to say the least.
I would have to say, for me, my favorite, I would say, if I were to go with monster, basic monster films, I would definitely say, as much as I love the fighting game, the fighting melee monster games for the Godzilla franchise on the GameCube and PS2, I would have to say the original on the NES was fine, because I don't know how they made it work, but they made a Godzilla platformer work. I mean, you go through a level where it just seems so totally nonsensical. You go through mountains, you go through plant-infested planets, size levels, and then you fight a monster at the very end, almost Street Fighter style. And it worked. It was good. I enjoyed it. If I wanted to stick with horror, I would definitely also say Alien Isolation, mainly for the fact that it is the first game to literally scare the shit out of me since Silent Hill 2.
I will also note that somebody made a creepypasta based on that Godzilla game that was pretty interesting.
Yeah, so Alien Isolation, I would have to say definitely probably one of the best scares I ever had was the fact that with the Xbox One, you can activate the Kinect, and the mic would work as, like, you. So if you breathe heavily, the xenomorph can hear you.
Yes, also you could pop your head out. That was awesome with it.
So that's why I think it would work perfectly as a VR game for that kind of type of engagement. So we're going to have to now end it there and move on to our next topic of conversation, which is the holiday season coming up. Yeah, I actually started seeing Christmas decorations going up at a freaking Kmart about 3 months ago. So, but now we're here. We're a week and a half away from Thanksgiving and fun times. So just like we were talking about with the NES Classic, you know, that's apparently one of the big hot items coming out right now. Of course, as we all know, there's always going to be problems on Christmas Day when it comes to, let's say, somebody getting a brand new system, Xbox One, PS4, whatever, and they want to hop online, and they can't get online because the servers are being pummeled to death with DDoS attacks, or too many people are hopping online, and the servers just weren't ready for it, or whatever. So, what are some of the things that you are just not looking forward to this holiday season? And we'll start with you, Keith, since you work in retail.
Well, the first thing is that one thing that I'm not really looking forward to for it is that there really aren't, besides just like three games I can narrow it down to really two games. There's not a whole lot of great games that are really coming out. It's usually the same, like, okay, you have Call of Duty that's coming out. Okay, you've already had Madden come out in August, and then you have Battlefield 1, so you already have like your classic first persons and whatnot that are gonna sell. They sell especially around this time of year. There wasn't really too much that really stood out on me. I know that I think it was Nick that said that Final Fantasy 15 is coming out. I'm not intrigued by Final Fantasy 15. Played the demo for it. I'm not impressed with it, honestly. I may buy it. I may play it later on down the line. I don't know. What's going to be interesting this holiday season alone is that there is a lot of new hardware that's coming out. So you got the PlayStation VR, you got the PlayStation 4 Pro, you have the Xbox One S, and that's always, again, around the holiday times. And you may see a lot of different attacks, like you said, because there's always that one asshole that just has to ruin it for everybody for that. And yeah, really, the thing that I'm really just disappointed with this year is just the lineup of games. There's really nothing that was like, oh, this is definitely the holiday seller for it.
And then, of course, Battlefield 1. Isn't that what you want?
Yeah,
apparently that's what everybody thinks we want.
Well, clearly, I want that game yesterday. Yes? No, not really. But it just didn't really... it's just not my... There again, it's lack of games, really. But a lot of hardware this year. One thing that I think that there may be a lot of issues is there's going to be with the PlayStation VR is that people are not going to... There may be issues with it. There may not be enough games for it. They may not live up to the hype that a lot of people were going for. One thing that I could probably say in particular my section of retail is that we would see a lot of Gear VRs being sold. So I guess that would technically be considered gaming. And some people just really are not either impressed by it or they do buy it and they use it as a fad. It's the usual holiday time. But again, nothing really is standing out this year to really pop, I would say, for that. So I'm just not looking forward to the same old, where's Call of Duty Infinite? Where's Battlefield 1? I could care less about those. I really wanted something exciting for this holiday season. But, of course, Pokemon is one of the games that I am also looking forward to. And, again, The Last Guardian.
Comes out in about, what, 3 days? Friday?
Well, Pokemon comes out in 4 days on the 18th.
Yeah, Friday. So, okay.
Friday.
Friday, so there you go. All right, so how about you, Mark? What are you not looking forward to this holiday season?
Like, we're specifically going for what do I not want to play?
Well, obviously not what you want to play, but what you're not looking forward to. Like, I'm sure you want to play online or something like that with a game or whatever. I mean, you're into security, and I did listen to your one podcast on Neo Kobe Pizza where you're talking about security issues and server issues and stuff like that.
I don't necessarily feel like the DDoSes are as big of a problem from a security perspective. That's just distributed denial of service is basically just a way to prevent people from having access to a resource. Now, you can use those as a way of trying to breach your way into somebody's system, to be sure, but for the most part, you're generally just going to use it to screw somebody over. For the most part, I think a lot of DDoSes or the DDoS issues that happen around the holiday season come from a shitload of people just getting on who weren't available and the companies not having the infrastructure in place to support it, which you would think would not be a problem now because they had all the time in the world to get it ready with during the PlayStation 3 and Xbox One or Xbox 360 time periods. But we'll see. That said, I am definitely not looking forward to the Steam sale and the relevant like Steam accounts getting jacked up and hacked and everything that's going to end up coming out of that. Because as we recall last year, you would get instances where you would like purchase something and somebody else's account information came up for like a brief window, which was not great.
Yeah, that was a weird occurrence. It didn't happen to me, thankfully, but...
Yeah, I don't think they got anything relevant, and it wasn't hacking so much as it was just bad cross-site scripting, apparently, but it's still definitely I'm not looking forward to something breaking in Steam this time around. I'm not especially worried about any holiday-oriented hacks, because in a lot of cases, hackers take the holidays off, as weird as that sounds. And I think going forward, the major trends are going to be more towards non-state actors from other countries trying to do things rather than, you know, Anonymous trying to hit Sony or Anonymous trying to hit Microsoft or whatever. Not that that's not going to happen, but it's just not likely to be the focal point of the year from my perspective. What am I not looking forward to? You can put me down as another person who's not looking forward to Final Fantasy 15. Sorry, Nick and Tahu. I know that that's a thing you guys are looking forward to, and I don't begrudge you that. I'm not saying it's, you know, you're bad or you're wrong for liking it, but for me personally, it's just I've been kind of on the outs with the three-dimensional Final Fantasies since 7 and 10 in succession. 13 did nothing to convince me that that was worth investing in, and while I do like 14 quite a bit, 15 I don't think is going to be the game that's going to draw me back in from an interest perspective. Beyond that, I don't really have anything I'm not looking forward to this year. This year has been terrible for, you know, life events, but from a gaming perspective, 2016 has been the shit. And I'm not gonna apologize for that because this year has been fucking awesome as far as games go. There are lots of great games that are still coming out between now and the end of the year. And, you know, it's just awesome. Like, going into January, in January, there are a bunch of major releases I'm looking forward to. That never fucking happens.
Now, let's move on to the next part. What are you looking for into the holiday season and beyond? I mean, we could definitely hold off on talking about what we're looking forward to 2017 for, I guess, the last podcast of the year. But why don't we just get a head start? We'll just start with the first couple of months of the year.
Well, if we're talking about me,
yeah, you.
Just talking about December in general, Steins Gate Zero, I'm kind of looking forward to a little bit. Dead Rising 4, definitely looking forward to. Last Guardian, just to see how it turns out, because I didn't like Ico. I'm sorry, I just didn't like it. I thought it was aesthetically interesting, but it was mechanically awful. But I did like Shadow of the Colossus, and I'm hoping that even with all of the delays, The Last Guardian learned from the failings of Shadow of the Colossus and has if it's going to be the last game from that development house, hopefully it's one that's worth waiting for mechanically, if nothing else.
Hope it doesn't turn out to be like Duke Nukem Forever.
Worst it's going to be is technically inferior. And if, so long as it's still interesting, I'm not that worried about it. Wild Guns Reloaded is, you know, looks awesome. And I love the original Wild Guns, so that's not a contest for me. Going into January, Fate Extella is looking to be really good. If you like Dynasty Warriors style games and the Fate series, which I do and they do. Gravity Rush 2 is kind of on my radar just because I liked the original, but not necessarily the way it was implemented with the Vita. So seeing it on the PlayStation 4 is definitely a positive for me. Yakuza 0, because I love the Yakuza series, and there's nothing really more complicated to it than that. Resident Evil 7, of course. Just, of course. I'm hoping for the best on that one, and it's almost here. And without going too far into February, obviously I'm looking forward to Persona 5. Like, that's not even a question.
I knew that was going to make the list. I freaking knew it. I was like, he's going to say Persona 5. If
Mark,
he doesn't,
Persona
5? Really disappointed
no.
with them.
All
right. Hey, you know what? You know what? You can kiss my butt. How about that? That game's going to be awesome.
Oh, it's going to be interesting. I was just saying, if it didn't make your list, I would be horribly disappointed in you.
Uh-huh.
I think we would all be shocked if it
didn't
make
your
list.
Listen, if you don't have anything to look forward to this year, you can just start playing Final Fantasy XIV. How about that?
Well, there you go. Well, I have a list.
All right, so how about you, Keith? What are you looking forward to, both game-wise or hardware-wise?
Well, I mean, obviously, I'm very intrigued by the Switch, to which apparently a price leak came out today from Toys R Us in Canada that it's supposed to have a $250 price tag, so I'm intrigued by that. I really don't want to go into too much, because, again, I would like to save a little bit or have a little bit more of a better list, but off the top of my head, I definitely am looking forward to South Park. That game is going to be freaking awesome because I love RPGs. I love South Park. So the Fractured Butthole definitely has my total vote on that one. Other than that one in particular, hopefully we'll see something about Zelda. But after that, I can't really think of too many in 2017 that I'm like, oh, I definitely have to go out and really, really buy it. I know I'm probably going to eat my words on that one, because then I'll see like something that's like a major. And Horizon Zero Dawn. That was another one that I was looking forward to.
Okay.
That PlayStation 4 game that we saw at E3. That was like, wow, a hunting. It was like that. That was that Monster Hunter-esque kind of game on PlayStation 4.
All right. So, what do you think is going to be the hot selling item? Is it going to be the PlayStation VR, the Xbox One Slim? What do you guys think it's going to be? We'll go with you, Keith.
Oh, by far PlayStation VR. By far PlayStation VR. I don't think that there really is too much of a huge market to resell the Xbox One S and the PlayStation Pro or PlayStation 4 Pro, just because all it is not really adding too much to it as far as specs are concerned, except for like 4K streaming, which I guess 4K TVs are becoming a lot more available because they've already released all the Black Friday stuff. They're like, oh, here's what's coming Black Friday. If you want to like come in by massive drones, let's do this. So a lot of 4K TVs are on sale. So maybe that could be a little bit of a push, but again, if you already own an Xbox One, you already own a PlayStation 4, I don't see much of a drive to really buy these newer systems. So PlayStation VR by far would make the definite top seller list, like dollars to donuts, I would say that by far. And also the Nintendo DS, since that's going on sale, that's gonna be only $100 for this season. I think that's definitely gonna be like out of the woodwork, especially with Pokemon being released.
All right, how about you, Mark? Same question.
I don't really think PSVR is gonna be a big seller, just because I feel like it's too early for that to be a definitive thing outside of like tech speculators and, you know, the sort of people that buy every hot new piece of hardware that comes out. Pokemon is definitely going to be lighting up the sales charts. That's not even a question. Call of Duty, obviously, is going to be another huge thing that's going to be lighting up the sales charts for the foreseeable future, I suspect. I'm hoping Final Fantasy 15 will do okay, just because I really feel like Square Enix has been banking a lot on that, and I think it's going to hurt if they can't get that where they need it to be, because again, remember, they were banking on Tomb Raider being a huge success, and like the CEO had to freaking step down when it didn't like do absolute gangbusters. I don't think it's going to do the numbers that they want, but you know, for their sake, I'm hoping that they can get somewhere close to it.
Well, to be truthfully honest, in fairness to Final Fantasy 15, I think they've been doing a rather decent job promoting the game. The cinematic trailers and like commercials that they've been showing make the game do look real good.
Sure, but JRPGs have been kind of on the downswing outside of the niche crowd. And to be fair, the niche crowd has been carrying it quite a bit. But I don't necessarily feel like that's going to be enough to give it the kind of sales that they want it to have.
Yeah, I don't
Final Fantasy 13 did not help necessarily either, I don't think. No. So it's going to be interesting to see how it plays out.
Okay, so... Anyway,
I have to agree with Mark with that. Yeah. I want to see Square Enix do good. I really do. But the whole thing is that like Mark was saying, is that the JRPG crowd, they definitely like been carrying everything as far as that's concerned. But I do not see Final Fantasy 15 going beyond that. I don't think it's going to draw in people like Final Fantasy 7 did for the PlayStation or anything along those lines, to be honest with you.
All right. Now, last question. Which system do you think is going to win the holiday war? Because coming in hot is the Xbox One with, what is it, 4 consecutive weeks of beating the PlayStation 4? Or was it 4 months? I'm not sure in terms of sales. Or do you think the PlayStation 4 and 4 Pro are going to squeak by? We'll go with you, Mark.
PlayStation 4 is going to win. Not a question. Not even a question. Mm-hmm. It's good for Microsoft that they've managed to get some consistent sales out there, and I'm sure Dead Rising 4 is only going to help as far as that goes. But let us not forget what the disparity is here in terms of what they're trying to aim for. Okay? Numbers that we know right now, okay? Microsoft has not announced units sold as of fucking December of 2013. That's how goddamn embarrassing that their sales have been for this console. Units shipped was 10 million as of November of 2014. 10 million as of 2014. And that's just shipped out to retailers, not even purchased off the shelves. They have not announced a number in 2 years. That is mortifying. That is horrifying. The number that they have at this point, they are goddamn embarrassed about it, period. This is Sony Vita levels of like depressing. Sony, meanwhile, 40 million as of May sold, 48 million as of September shipped. Whatever number Microsoft had before they started beating the PlayStation 4, it wasn't that high.
Well, Microsoft, it was higher than the Wii U at least.
Sure, but the Wii U died, like just died, like the moment it came
literally
out. Hey guys, I'm here to done. Forget it. So it's honestly, Microsoft would need to, let's say that they're at 20 million, all right, like right now, let's before they even started making sales, you would need to move 20 million units this holiday season.
Yeah,
you have a better
possible.
Chance of getting struck by lightning while winning the lottery as a sharky Microsoft has selling 20 million units worldwide this holiday season. It's going to be Sony. Sony is still going to rule the roost for another year. Sorry. Mm-hmm.
And Keith, I assume you agree with him?
I agree with him to a certain extent. I definitely think that Xbox is not going to sell too well just because there's no great games for it. There really isn't. It's like, what are people going to buy? Gears of War 4? No. Like, that's definitely not... like a game that I think is going to be the system seller, to be honest with you. So I would say that the PlayStation 4, but I'm actually, just to go against the grain in this conversation a little bit, I'm going to probably say that the new 3DS XL or the new 3DS is going to probably be the top selling system this year.
That's actually, if we're talking about if we're talking about the things that move the most units just in the holidays, I would say it's probably going to be that. Yeah.
Yeah. Because of just on the backs of Pokemon alone.
And then also, it still has a lot of good games that are out for it too. That just, and plus the fact that it's only gonna be $100 is a really, really good starter for that as well. So I think that's gonna do very well. But if you're talking about the major consoles, then yes, PlayStation 4, because they have a really great game lineup. Everything is real. Sony really took their heads out of their asses. I'm really proud of them. I hope they keep up the momentum with that.
All right, so holiday 2016 is here and upon us. So I am going to I made this silly little post on Facebook. So I'm going to plead to everybody out there who works in retail. Please be kind to the shoppers as they return their consoles after being pissed off for not connecting to Xbox Live or PSN because they had a bad time, and their little kids were fucking screaming their heads off at them because they couldn't connect. So just kill them with a smile.
Speaking of somebody who worked in retail for multiple Black Fridays, we in customer service are a mirror of that, which we are asked to deal with. If you are not a good customer, we are not a good employee. That's all I'm saying. That's all I'm saying.
Mm-hmm.
Words to live by.
Yep. So, we're gonna,
just be nice to me.
So we're not gonna end the show right away. Apparently this has become a tradition at the end of the show, so we have a very active audience today, so we are gonna turn the attention to you. So feel free to ask us some questions, anything that comes off the top of your head, and we will try and answer them to the best of our abilities. So
I'd say we probably have enough time for like three, maybe four.
Yeah, about three or four questions, and so go right ahead, guys. Start typing away, and we will answer them. So
pressure's
probably
on
the
right
worst
now.
Part, the silence of waiting for somebody to answer or ask us a question. Here we go. All right, so first question. We're going to start with Mark answering this one off. What's a canceled game you wish you could play?
The PlayStation 2 remake of Phantasy Star 4.
Well, Snoop Dogg's Fear and Respect.
Could you technically even call that a canceled game, considering it never even entered development?
It was planned, and it was clearly planned, because they had announced the 3-pack of the remade games to be released in the U.S., so it was clearly in the planning stages and just never happened.
Okay. For me, it would be Sonic Extreme. And there is kind of a possibility it may be released in the future, thanks in part to this guy named Andrew75 on the Sonic forums, who was working on something called Project ASXX. AXSX, sorry. So just go ahead and check it online. He is trying to recreate the game with the Unreal 4 engine, so there's this good possibility of that. Otherwise, any canceled games I practically found betas of and have been playing. So next question, any more questions? Come on, hit us up with questions.
We like the question.
Yeah. So, while we wait for a question, why don't you tell us, what some of that stuff you got on the back over there, Keith?
Like as far as, my wall of stuff here.
Yeah.
Well, since I've decided to go, oh, now all of a sudden here come all the questions now.
Yeah. So, real quick, we'll go with Tahu's questions first. Strategy games, are they dying or making a comeback? Keith.
Ooh, now by strategy games, if you're talking like RTSs, or are we talking about like Defense Force games? Or because as far as RTSs are concerned, I think that they're not really dying. I think that they're still quite alive and well, just because you do have a lot of great, you have StarCraft 2, which is still out. So that's still, if anything, they're re-releasing all three of them together. So that, oh, okay, RTSs, okay. So as RTSs, I think that they are quite alive and well. We have not seen too many of them, but also we have Halo Wars 2 coming out. So I think that, they're still alive and well, and they really appeal to more of that niche audience versus to a wider spread. So I don't think that they will come out as big as they did like in the early 2000s, when you had like Axis and Allies, and you had StarCraft, and then you had Warcraft 3, and then you had the Frozen Throne and all them. But I don't think that they're really dying out. I think they're quite alive and well.
What are your thoughts, Mark?
I feel like StarCraft II is kind of the logical endpoint for that sort of thing. I feel like MOBAs are kind of starting to occupy that space that RTS games occupied because of the fact that they work off of the resource management kind of concepts, but in a much more Twitch fashion. So I definitely don't think they're going to go away anytime soon because there's still a dedicated fan base for them. You know, you've got a lot of independent developers, especially under the Paradox banner, who put out those sorts of games and push for them to be a success. But I think like StarCraft II for a while is going to be the height, prominence wise, that we're going to see from them for a time. At least until the MOBA market flattens out a bit.
Yeah,
I would say probably.
Oh,
yeah, and they're trying to constantly redefine the MOBA to eventually get it away from the RTS roots that it started from with Dota. So I would say give it like 3 to 5 years before we start to see any kind of a spike back up for the RTS genre. Right now, I'm going to say that they probably hit their apex and are on their way down for the time being. I don't think they're going to die out completely because, again, there's a lot of people who love 4X and 6X real-time strategy games. But I definitely think they're on the downswing for the time being.
Okay. Here's another question from Nick. If you could make a game, what kind would it be, Mark?
I had this idea for making a game like forever ago called Garden Fighter, where it would be like this combination between Harvest Moon and Street Fighter, where you would start out like making like a little window box, and you would like grow plants in it, and then you would eventually like upgrade to like bigger and bigger plots. And then like once you got to a certain point, you would like have to go up against somebody else who was also like growing plants, and like your different farms or like plant whatevers would compete against one another, and then you would have like a physical one-on-one Street Fighter style fight. Where you'd have, like, characters who'd use, like, watering cans and hoses and, like, hoes and rakes and shit as weapons in battle. It's a really fucking stupid idea, but that was, like, that's the first thing that comes to mind when that question comes up.
How about you, Keith?
If I were to make a game, like, this is such a serious question. Like, I wish I could have, like, a funny, like, anecdotal one, but for me, at least, this is a serious question. I would really like to make a Legend of Zelda game that is kind of like an Elder Scrolls-esque, that it's just very wide, it's very big, it's not really ending, there's constant updates to it to kind of expand on the story. Or if I could make a game, I guess would be the more opposing question to what they're asking, would be I would make a game that's kind of a little bit like Elder Scrolls, but it's a little bit more of a grander scale going on for it with an amazing story and just amazing combat, like almost like you go in and you can actually fight a little bit more to that. I don't know. It's a really, really good question, but I wish I had a little bit more like something funny to say or something better to say, honestly.
For me, the type of game I would make, I actually have kind of an affinity for dungeon crawler first-person RPGs. So, like, I'm a big fan of, let's say, like, the Eye of the Beholder franchise or Dungeon Master. Even, what was that? What were those recent games that just came out, actually, for the, crap, I can't remember the game's name. Legend of Grimrock. Those games that came out, and even Might and Magic 10, and maybe the Shining in the Darkness and Shining the Holy Ark. I really like those style of games, and I wouldn't mind maybe making a type of like a first person dungeon crawler RPG like that. That would be kind of fun, I think. I would try and come up with some like weird, unique twists to it that I don't think have been applied yet, but I'm kind of have to sit back and think on that for a while. So we'll see. We got one more time for a question here. Let's see. Jesus Christ, a bunch of just stuff popped up while we were talking.
I think we can fit the two in and then be done with it.
All right. Real quick, reboots. Are they a good idea or a bad idea to do? I'll go first on this one. Reboots, it really depends. If it's a reboot of a franchise that just hasn't been around that long, let's say like maybe 5 years, no, it does not need to be done. If it's a franchise like, say, the Tomb Raider franchise, that's about 20 years old and It kind of got stale, and you need to reintroduce the character and the concept and all that stuff. Yeah, go right ahead. I mean, it's a great way. I mean, you're practically now bringing in a new generation of gamers who you want to reintroduce lore to. So I would say that's a good idea and a good example of doing a reboot to a game. Mark, what are your thoughts?
Pretty much the exact opposite, actually.
Oh, dear.
My logic is you have a case to make a reboot, a reasonable reboot, in two cases. Well, in three cases, I would say. The first possible case is if your franchise has been dead for quite a long period of time, and attempting to reintroduce it with a straight sequel would require modern gamers to know far too much information for them to get invested in it. Splatterhouse is a prime example of how that can be done properly. The last game in the franchise came out on the Sega Genesis, and that is way too much of an amount of time to expect gamers to remember the games that you have released previously. So it's your best bet is to reboot the franchise. Whether you liked the game or not, it was a sound idea. Second case is if the games in the series have been on a progressively downward trend and gamers are, you know, like you're clearly not doing particularly well with it. You need to start somewhere fresh because the games that you've been making have just not been very good and you want to approach it with clear eyes. I can't think of something that particularly strikes that to my mind off the top of my head. But like in general, if the games that you've been releasing have either been extremely poorly received or just been extremely poorly done, rebooting is as good of an opportunity as you've got at that point. The third case is if you've told every possible story that you can tell, like there's just no further direction for you to go in with that franchise. It's just the concept is tapped out. At that point, I think a reboot is probably going to be your best option. So it's like, as an example, the Splatterhouse reboot, I think, was a perfectly fine idea. XCOM reboot, perfectly fine idea. The Bionic Commando reboot, perfectly fine idea. The Devil May Cry reboot, I think was Capcom. I don't hate that game mechanically. The narrative is a little too much They Live for my liking, and I don't want to give that game props for, you know, using somebody else's idea blatantly and demonstrably in order to get itself over. But mechanically, I think the game is good. The problem is, I feel like that game was a case of Capcom just not knowing where to go with the Dante character. And that's not the same thing as there not being a good place to go with the character, because as Bayonetta has showed, there's lots of ridiculous shit you can do with these characters to make it work. Tomb Raider, I also don't think was a particularly good idea for a reboot, because you could have just taken that game and put the original Laura into that game, and it would have worked out perfectly fine. I think at this point, the only reason we rebooted Laura was so that we could try and make her more identifiable conceptually, and, you know, more power to them and whatever. I personally don't think that what they've done with the franchise is good in the strictest sense of things outside of the mechanics, but people clearly seem to like it, so to each their own.
All right, and how about you, Keith?
I think Mark kind of hit it on the head, to be honest with you, is that there's quite a few, I actually agree with both of you, that there's quite a few different areas of opportunity of where there would be a reboot that needs to be put in. I think that, if anything, they should be rebooting series that have not been around quite some time. Like Mark said, like Splatterhouse, I actually have Splatterhouse on the Xbox 360. I didn't think it was that bad. But anyway, I think that if they were absolutely running out of ideas, then yes, I think a reboot is nice for, like, to bring back an older series to make it more more appealing to newer generations and still getting the same thing out. But I really would like to see a little bit more of newer ideas, and then later on down the road, I think there should be a time limit, really, on how long of when the reboot should be made. So I guess Tomb Raider would be a prime example, because like you said, it's been 20 years, so to make it a little bit more appealing to more people, change it around a little bit. I guess would be the better saying. If anything, one thing that I would like to see a complete reboot on is, again, if anybody hasn't picked up already, I'm a huge Legend of Zelda fan. I would really like to see the original Legend of Zelda get a nice, like, little reboot. I think that would be very intriguing, to say the least.
All right, and we'll just do this weird question, and then we're going to call it a night on this one. If any Nintendo character was secretly running a bordello or brothel, who would it be, and why is it Yoshi? Well, let's go with the most colorful person in the room and get the answer, Mark.
I'm not sure if I should be offended by that or not. I'm going to be honest. I feel like it's going to be Daisy, actually. Because she's not really around very much. Like, she shows up in the, you know, we're going to do all of the Mario and Friends things, but, like, she's not really a main character in the strictest sense, or even, like, a top-tier secondary character as far as the other games go. So, I mean, she's clearly got to be doing something in order to keep herself in them nice princess dresses and whatnot. Mm-hmm. I'm just saying.
I think it's Toad. Like, I could totally see Toad, like, just, like, get back in the fucking room, bitch. Like, totally. I think that would be hilarious. And why is Yoshi it? Because Yoshi is pimp, and, like, clearly because he's green, and that's the reason why.
I think it's actually Bowser, and he's actually a pimp, and he's constantly going after Princess Peach because that's his bottom bitch that keeps running away from him.
I like that one.
I mean, that went to a weird place.
Yes, it did go to a weird place. I mean, think about it. How does this man manage to afford multiple castles in the sky, a bunch of flying vehicles, some pimped out looking car? I mean, look at Super Mario 3D Land. That is a big purple car with some spiked rims.
To be fair, I just always assumed he got them from magic, but whatever.
And not to mention, he has a whole lot of kids, so, like, how do these kids come about?
In fact, even Bowser Jr. claims that Princess Peach is his mom, so I'm just saying. I mean, whatever. So we're going to end the show on a weird note. Let's do some quick plugs real quick. Keith, tell us about your stream.
If anything, I'm trying to get my stream up and running. It's twitch.tv/thegamerkeith. I'm still writing, I'm still ironing a lot of the stuff out. If anything, to be honest with you, I'm mainly just doing this at the meantime. I think that's really going to be something in 2017, but I did do Extra Life this week, or the last weekend? Yeah, or was it this week? I forget. All the days are running together, unfortunately. And that was a lot of fun. So I'm still kind of like projecting where this is going at the second. Mostly this is a lot of fun that I get to go on the podcast. This is the only real structured thing that I have going on at the second.
All right, how about you, Mark? Plug your stuff.
Well, you can check me out on the weekends over at my live stream at hitbox.tv/markbwriting. You can check out my podcast, Neo Kobe Pizza, the only gaming podcast that floats in soup, over at soundcloud.com/markbwriting, as well as on iTunes, Google Music, Stitcher, and basically anywhere that hosts a podcast at this point. And you can check out my writing over at Die Hard Game Fan or markbwriting.com, though I haven't been particularly prolific with the writing, again, due to my life being a mess right now. Going into the new year, I feel like that's something that's probably going to change up quite a bit.
All right. And for me, be sure to check out gamingvisionnetwork.com for, you know, any kind of stuff that I post, podcasts. I post the links to the MP3 version up on there. Sometimes I'll post an article or a game review on there. Every Wednesday, this coming Wednesday, is going to be a game jam, and my brother and a friend of his is going to be coming over. We're going to be playing both Ninja Turtle arcade games, so that's going to be a lot of fun. We will be doing game jam up until December 14th, and then after that, we will be doing winter break. In fact, after today, we will be doing two more GVN live shows. The next one will be the 28th of November, and then the last show for the year will be December 12th. So we're going to be taking a good holiday break, and we will be returning, but we'll talk about that another time. So, yeah, get all your news and information at gamingvisionnetwork.com, or follow me on our follow us on our Twitter pages, which we have posted right below our cameras. So This is Fight Club Hubs. I want to thank Keith and Mark B for once again joining me on this show. And Emily out there, I hope you're feeling better. And hope to see you on the next show. Thank you, everybody, for tuning in. So thank you and good night.
Good night, everybody.